Well, Wayne, here we are at Penistone railway station in his own backyard from Barnsley. Right. And it's now closed, of course, except for this line here. Right. The actual station were built in 1874. The line were opened in 1849. The original station were about a mile on track there.
Right.
But yeah, it was a very, very busy station. 360 trains a day, and now there's just 1 an hour from Sheffield, Barnsley, Huddersfield on this line. There were five platforms here, and platform five here were the Barnsley line, Barnsley Courthouse, Doncaster.
Right.
So, which we've got on an old dirt photo. But very, very, it's a lovely place, absolutely fantastic. It's still here, the old station, of course, the remnants on it, but...
This had been one of the main lines for coal then, from different pits?
That's why it were opened
for
up...
For
coal from Manvers, Woth, that area. That's where the line started, Doncaster, Woth, and came here, or over to Manchester, Warrington, a power station called Fiddler's Ferry.
Right.
And that's where all the it was like a merry-go-round system,
right,
where the full trains went from Yorkshire that way, westward to Warrington, and then came back empty this way. Yeah.
Right.
But as I said, thousands of navvies were killed here. I did all my research when I wrote my book, the Woodhead Diaries, and I've got a load of films what I want you to watch. And the first one is. A fantastic 1969 film, Engines Must Not Enter the Potato Siding. It's a BBC film, so we're going to watch actual clips on it, all relating to Penistone.
And the former Great Central Line from Sheffield, Victoria, across the Pennines by way of Penistone and Woodhead to Manchester. The hourly Manchester train pulls out from Sheffield for a journey of 41 miles, running across high moors or cutting through them. The engineer who designed this line said it would join the East and West Seas. He meant you would be able to sail from the Baltic to a port on the English East Coast, come by rail to Sheffield, then travel his line to Manchester, continue to Liverpool, and there catch the Atlantic packet to New York. And just about here, his grand railway began on December the 22nd, 1845, when the first through train on the Sheffield, Ashton-under-Lyne, and Manchester Railway left Bridgehouses Station. For many years past, the old station has been used as a goods depot, and now they're pulling it down. It was at Bridgehouses that they had the potato siding, Engines Must Not Enter, because the warehouse floor wasn't strong enough to take them, and they would have fallen 30 feet into the road. But 5 years before the first train ran, the first men on this line were navvies like these, who built it with their picks and shovels. In the 1840s, there were 200,000 of them working all over England. And a tough and rowdy lot they were.
In 1941, me corduroy breeches I put on. Me corduroy breeches I put on to work upon the railway. I'm weary of the railway. Poor Paddy works on the railway. In 1842, from Hartlepool I moved to Crewe and found myself a job to do, a working on the railway. I was wearing corduroy breeches, digging ditches, dodging hitches, pulling switches. I was working on the railway.
Tunnel building was the hardest task. An artist of the time saw it like this. The most notorious tunnel of all was on the Sheffield-Manchester line at Woodhead, where 1,500 men hacked and blasted 3 miles 20 yards through millstone grit, shale, slate and clay. When he saw the plans, George Stephenson said he would eat the first train through the tunnel. These are the moorland churches where they never went alive, but only to be buried. Their deaths are recorded in the parish registers at Penistone and in the chapel of St. James at Woodhead. They died when falling rock caught them, or they fell 600 feet down a ventilating shaft, or stood too close to the blasting. John Young, killed on the railway, aged 59. Robert Blackburn, aged 38. John Thorpe, aged 24. And their children died too in the shanty camps. John Henry Newton, aged 9 months. And then there was cholera. They suffered cramps, their fingers shriveled, their eyes sank, they turned blue. A doctor from Manchester prescribed port wine as a remedy, and they died. The others, when they saw a load of coffins brought up to Woodhead to supply the expected need, ran away and spread the infection over Lancashire and Cheshire. 28 died in one brief epidemic. The last was Rachel Fuchs, who came to nurse the men on a Friday, was afraid from the first, and died on the Monday. The navvies' greatest memorial is the tunnel they built, which was, at the time, the longest in the world.
Under steam, it was always quite a task keeping to time. A lot depended on the conditions of the engine, and these varied considerably, much more so than the diesel and electrics. There was probably much more margin for error, let's put it that way, both human and mechanical. With the electrics and dieselisation, of course, it was a different world altogether for locomotive men. I think we look back on steam with a small sigh of nostalgia and a great big sigh of relief. Approaching Penistone now. Penistone, I should think, is one of the coldest places in England in the winter. During the snow and frost, conditions can be rough with the electrics, where you get quite a lot of slipping. We have to take great care not to get the resistances of the engine hot. They burn out, the engine is a failure. And that means probably someone got a quite a long walk, possibly the driver.
The Midland Line. Now the Midland was a solid railway, which flourished by carrying coal and iron and by looking after its passengers. In 1872, it admitted third-class passengers to all its trains, not just the slow ones. In 1875, it upholstered all third-class carriages, which was unheard of. This line, the Sheffield-Manchester, though it never paid, was the first in the country to be electrified for both passenger and goods trains. The change to overhead electrification started before the war, long before today's intercity electrification out of Euston.
We've left Penistone now on the road to Dumford. That is the eastern end of Woodhead Tunnel.
After Penistone, the country is wild, with more sheep than men. It's a place where nothing much has happened since they first built the line. There's still a vague tradition about the cholera epidemic of 1849, only they talk about it as the plague. This is the new Woodhead tunnel built for the electrification. The old tunnels, which are closed now, had an evil reputation. The train smoke gathered so densely and hung around so long that the gangers maintaining the line often had trouble feeling their way through, even with lamps. Many got silicosis, and some became invalids after as little as 6 years. It's always been damp and smelly. Railwaymen called it Under the Hill, and said you could get an idea of the tunnel taste by drinking bad port wine and savouring the taste it left in your mouth afterwards. Sometimes the drivers were half suffocated. The footplate was smothered in steam and dirty smoke, and the driver and fireman had to crouch low down to get some breathable air.
When I used to try to have a good fire on and keep the smoke down as much as possible, because it was terrifying in the tunnel, because it hit the chimney and came back onto you, and you couldn't sometimes see your mate at the other side, you know what he was doing. You were sometimes gasping for breath, and you were damn glad to get through in anything like reasonable time.
And it was terrible to breathe. It was just like breathing carbon, just like putting your head in a firebox and breathing that. So what we used to do, we used to have a bucket of water on the footplate, have an handkerchief or a white rag, as the company used to give us, dip it in the bucket and wrap it round your mouth. See, and get in the corner.
Woodhead signal box and signalman Michael Gattonby, age 21. When he left school, he worked in a shop, then a factory, then a mill. But he'd been interested in railways since he was 5, and when he was 18, he decided to train as a signalman. His is one of the loneliest boxes on the line, but a busy one. His basic pay is £17.07.
One of the most responsible jobs there is, signalman, no doubt about it. Come to think of it. It's more important than the pilots. A pilot has got the lives of the people in the plane in his hands. A signalman has got the lives of the, say, two passenger trains coming up. Got all those lives. One wrong move, there's no element of mistakes in this job. It's a job where you can't make mistakes. Although they do happen, then we've seen the consequences. Control's ringing. Woodhead? Oh, David. Z70 down at 47. Two couple for Penistone at 12:13. That's it. Down fast, just coming out now. You've trained engine section. Just tell Dunford it's gone. That's a driver ringing in, and that train will be up good to tell me that he's arrived. Hello. Yeah. 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 Okay. Thank you.
Well, look what we've got here. This fella here, this Neville.
It is live in the person, Nev.
It's nice to see you, Nev. So you actually worked on the railway, did you?
Yes, I was the relief man on this station. So I had to cover every job.
Right, so yeah.
My most favourite one was doing the lamps, because you used to have to go down to Oxbridge Tunnel.
Yeah, yeah.
And up to Dunford that way.
Yeah.
I mean, the main signals were electric light, but the old ones were steel paraffin lamps. Yeah. So you have to trim the wicks and fill them up again.
I actually worked from this electric power station, you know, the actual control centre.
Yes.
The line closed in 81.
Yes.
Passenger trains 1970, freight 1981. So what happened after you then?
after it closed?
Oh, well, I left before it shut.
Did
then,
you?
Yeah.
And so you're a local lad here?
I used to live in Oxbridge till I got married, then moved to Thurlston, and then still at Thurlston.
Yeah. Oh, wonderful, so, wonderful. Yeah. And that's your year, is it? Yeah. Wonderful.
Yeah, well, that's the day when I was doing the porter's job. You had to open the guards van to see if anything for Penistone.
Right.
This really great big greyhound jumped out.
A greyhound?
Yeah, and it shot off up the platform towards Manchester.
Yeah, yeah.
And the station master shout, catch it, catch it. Well, I mean.
Yeah. No. Nev, question. Were you footbridge or were you underground subway under the line?
On the main line it was underground, but from David Brown's on platform one it was a footbridge to get. You used to come off. Oh, just. And back there.
Right, so if I got that right, the old Barnsley line was this end platform 5?
Yes.
Platform 5?
No, platform 5 or this.
Oh, have I got that wrong?
Yeah, the old thing, platform 1 was it from Barnsley.
Yeah, yeah. Doncaster-Wath, yeah. That line.
Then 2 and 3 was Sheffield and London and Manchester, Piccadilly.
Right,
and
right.
4 and 5 were the Huddersfield, this one, which is still running now. Like.
Yeah. Oh, wonderful. Oh, wonderful, Nev. You take care, mate.
Let's go first, then, to the north, pocketed with pits and factories, to the Pennines that stretch like a broad spine down the centre of England, from the Roman Wall to Derbyshire, a natural barrier that once was accessible only to the climber and the laden pack horse, and now to railways. 100 years ago, when Manchester was growing, already hungry for coal from the pits of Yorkshire, men built a railway that climbed the mountain barrier, and at Dunford Bridge they drove through the hills with chisel and pick to make the 3-mile Woodhead tunnel. Their handiwork remained. The tunnel is still one of Yorkshire's links with the West, but its age is against it, and hardly a week passes without repairs and delay. Today, our men are at work again, driving once more through the solid rock of the hills to build a better tunnel alongside the old, blasting down sandstone and shale, 20 tons at a time. In spite of the excavator and the drills, tunnelling hasn't changed. It isn't hard to think back 100 years to those other tunnellers, whose graves lie over the hill at Woodhead. And today, the roof is still the danger, and the rough arch, drilled and chipped out so laboriously, is still the only safeguard against the constant thrust of the mountain overhead. But this 12-foot tunnel is only a beginning, for once it's through, the whole heading has to be worked out with explosives and machines until it's big enough to take a double-track railway. And 1 million tons of Pennine rock will have been brought out into day. A 3-mile tunnel must have its ventilation shaft sunk vertically to meet the line 500 feet below. In this 16-foot circle, machines are mostly too large and complex for the work. And like the tunnellers of a century ago, the men must get to grips with the rock and the splintery shale, and contend with water that may course without warning from underground springs. A 3 years' job. 3 years fighting and changing nature. 3 years to build a tunnel through which electric expresses will pass in 3 minutes.
Right, Wayne, this is the Woodhead Tunnel this year.
Right, yep.
Three tunnels.
One here, 1839, 1845, and that one, the most modern, 1954. Mm-hmm. Now then, the tunnel is 3 miles, 30 yards long. The station Woodhead is roughly there. This is the western portal of the Woodhead Tunnel.
Now then, this is
Penistone Railway Station.
Yeah, and I recognise this straight away. This is Flying Scotsman.
Yeah. Is it 4472?
4472. Yeah. Mm. And I'll tell you why I know, because I've got it on a later film, which is on here, yeah, on it coming into Barnsley.
Right.
It was an excursion, you know, from Huddersfield to Cleethorpes, right, via Penistone, yeah.
What sort of year?
68. I can tell you, I believe August 68.
Yeah.
Because I've got another film which I'll show you in a minute.
LN Yard, London and North Eastern Railway.
Yeah. 4472. Cool. Why I knew that first carriage, I spotted it. The first carriage, it's on another film which I've got.
Yeah.
And it's early morning. Ends dark, you know.
I mean, it is dark, but obviously quality of film is not as good as it is now. Off we go towards
Barnsley.
Would it go on Barnsley line or down Sheffield?
No, it went through Barnsley. What's this in a minute? I've got it coming into the old exchange station. What were the original exchange?
Ah, right, yeah.
So watch now. That's the train leaving Penistone. And that's today, of course.
Yeah.
It's just same, there's no difference. Yeah,
other than just modernisation with waiting rooms, other than that, it's about the same.
All them coal lines have gone, of course, all them.
And the thing that's missing is obviously the overhead cables.
To the train.
Yeah. Which is a shame.
Because
my father worked on railway.
Did he? Yeah. Now then, Paul, that is it coming into Barnsley.
All right.
The old exchange station, that's the same train.
Yeah.
4472 Flying Scotsman.
Right.
And look at him there looking at him.
Yeah.
That's it, as I say, the same.
That doesn't exist now, does it?
Oh no, that's exactly how it is.
The station.
It's
now.
The bottom station.
Ah, right.
Barnsley at two stations, the courthouse, the top, and the exchange at the bottom.
Yeah.
So this is what it is now. Right. The old exchange station. As I said, the train were going to Cleethorpes. On an excursion.
I think the reason why I don't recognise some of it, there's a signal box, they don't exist anymore. See the signal box just disappearing there?
Yeah. Look, it's crystal clear, 4472. Yeah. Mm. In fact, I think it went down Stairfoot, didn't it? Stairfoot was still open, past Tesco.
Yeah.
Where Tesco is.
Yeah.
Now, this is your film.
Oh, my dad took this, it'll have taken it from a signal box somewhere. I'm guessing this is going to be sort of like Millhouse, or it could. I would have thought.
Well, the line shut in January 1970.
Yeah.
For passengers.
Yes.
1981 for freight.
So this is Thelston. I know this is Thelston. So right. That's come from Penistone. It's coming past Thelston.
Yeah.
There's a crossing where there's a farm now.
All right.
On Leppins Lane, and that'll be where that is. That's the old electrification bubble.
Yeah.
If you want to see one of them now, you've got to go to York.
I've seen there were two classes, Bobo and Coco.
Yeah, one, I can't remember which one, went to I think it was somewhere abroad.
Holland. Netherlands, yeah.
Boat train.
There was 1500 volt DC.
Yeah.
They reckon that's why it shook, because it was heavy, antiquated stuff, but it's up to conjecture.
The electric line from Tinsley Rotherwood and Sheffield Victoria trails in on the left. That's Barnsley Junction Box on stilts. The cream-coloured office block on the right is the line's electrical control station, where staff controlled and switched power to the whole Manchester-Sheffield-Wath DC system. Penistone, like so many British towns, once had a thriving goods yard for delivery of merchandise. The remains of Penistone Goods Yard are on the left. Dunford Bridge Box is on the right, followed immediately by the small Dunford Station and the eastern portal of the Woodhead Tunnel. That was 1954, the acclaimed modernisation lasting just 26 years. As we leave the tunnel, we pass the staff halt at Woodhead and Woodhead Box on the left. The line now descends through Longdendale towards the urban sprawl of Manchester. As we approach the western end of the tunnel, we can reflect that in just a few weeks after these pictures were taken, the Woodhead route was dead. A victim of what many people believe is a preference for short-term economies. Today's environmental considerations might have brought about a different result.
Friday, July the 17th, 1981, and the last complete day of workings over the Woodhead line. The enthusiasts were out despite the torrential rain, and this was summer. These 76s are awaiting their very last turn of duty at Barnsley Junction sidings. A Class 45 shunts the full coal wagons it has brought up from Dodworth Colliery. What had happened to one of British Railway's greatest post-war achievements was nothing less than a tragedy.
Hey. My mother's shinting as no tinting. 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 My mother's shinting.